Hello and welcome to this short documentary on Trombone Shorty. My name is Ryan Hattersley, and with the help of John Ball and Rihanna Fillet, we will be presenting a glimpse into the life and music of a great current jazz musician. Let's begin with his biography. Trombone Shorty was born on January 2nd, 1986 in New Orleans, Louisiana, and his real name is actually Troy Andrews. He began playing music at a young age and was professionally playing by 5 years old, and even became a band leader by the age of six. He was well known for his musical skills on the trombone and trumpet, but he mastered the drums, organ, and tuba as well. He is also a producer, actor, and philanthropist. He has an older brother named James Andrews, who is a musician in a jazz band as well, and his grandfather was a successful rhythm and blues singer. Now let's take a look a little bit more into his background. Trombone Shorty grew up in the Treme neighborhood of New Orleans, and in high school he joined the New Orleans Center for Creative Arts, which was a musical education program where he trained in music theory, ear training, and instrumental instruction. In 2003, he was one of five young musicians chosen as the subject for a PBS television documentary, and also performed the network's nationally broadcast tribute to Louis Armstrong. He also traveled extensively overseas, playing concerts and festivals in Cuba and Europe. He was involved in the creation of Global Song Kids, which is a compilation of children's songs played in the style of New Orleans marching bands. This recording was released in Japan. In 2012, he also partnered with Mitch Landrieu, New Orleans mayor, to create the Trombone Shorty Foundation. This foundation donated musical instruments to public schools and evolved into Trombone Shorty Academy, which became an after-school program for aspiring musicians. He has played with famous bands such as U2, Green Day, Zac Brown Band, and Rod Stewart. Now let's take a closer look at Trombone Shorty's music career. His music career began in 2002 when he released his first singular recording called Swinging Gate. It was acclaimed by jazz critics. In 2009, he created a band named Trombone Shorty and Ocean's Avenue and signed to Verve Records. He opened for Jeff Beck and Dave Matthews Band and performed at Bonnaroo and Bumbershoot Festivals. His music is classified as hard-edged funk and hip-hop beats with traditional jazz influence. He now belongs to Blue Note Records. Now let's take a look at some oral history as it pertains to Trombone Shorty. There are two videos examined in this documentary. One is the intimate interview with Trombone Shorty, and the other is Trombone Shorty and Orleans Avenue interview Lollapalooza 2014. There's one published article reviewed in this documentary, and that is 8 things we learned about Trombone Shorty during his Facebook Live interview. In this interview, Trombone Shorty talks about the various types of music he's involved with and also discusses his musical influences.
But is it fair to say you're a jazz musician?
I've been raised playing jazz a little bit in the city, so I think I'm just a musician at this point. You know, I've played different styles of music throughout my life. I've played some country music with some of the best country people, Zac Brown, and played some rock music with Lenny Kravitz, and I've just been very blessed to be able to share the stage with different people and different styles of music here in the city also. Like, we have subgenres of New Orleans music, and I've been able to be placed in those type of situations and share the stage with some of the legendary musicians to be able to gather my information and gather my education to be able to sound the way I sound today. So for me, at a young age, I was placed in different music that sound different. So I just thought music was music, and I just was a horn player just playing. Everything sounded like a gumbo.
Everything sounded like a gumbo.
Yeah, just everything in one. So to be young and to be that impressionable, everything just soaked in there. I've worked with Manny Fresh, who was a producer for Cash Money Records, which is hip hop. And I got introduced to all this music at a young age. So I was here and there. So everything just sounded like music to me. There was no boundaries in my ears. So whenever I perform, whenever I create, all of those experiences are coming with me.
That's good basic. What is jazz?
Oh, jazz to me, being in New Orleans, is more of in a traditional sense where it started here, it's dance music. You know, people, even still to the day, the New Orleans jazz is about dancing. That's what jazz is to New Orleans. A lot of emotions, happy music, feel good, people are dancing and partying, you know, like it's Mardi Gras year round.
In this interview, Trombone Shorty speaks about playing and traveling with his band.
So, you guys have had a busy day. You just flew in this morning. And yes. Played Lala, and now already on to the next one. How do you guys keep your energy up when, you know, you're traveling, you know, early morning and then...
Once the music takes over, we forget about everything.
Yeah.
Injuries, whatever it may be, the music just takes over and we forget. Now, when we're ending the show, and we know it's the ending, you can see some of the bands start to mentally crash and we're going down. But other than that, you know, we've been doing this for a few years now, maybe like close to 200 or more shows a year. So we're used to this and, you know, we'll see how long we can do it. Very young and exciting. Now, we play at all type of festivals. Yesterday, we played a jazz fest. They had seats and stuff. And today, it was just wonderful for us to play in front of our peers and have them accept the music and allowed us to bring them on a musical journey, and they react. You know, it doesn't matter if we have a hit song or not. They just let us take them there.
In the article, 8 Things We Learned About Trombone Shorty during his Facebook Live interview, several notable quotes stood out. One was, "Without the city, I wouldn't be who I am. I don't want to wait until I'm extremely old or about to retire from music to give back. I want to do it while things are growing for me and growing for the city. I feel like I have to give back because without this city, not just musicians, but people around the neighborhood, the kids, the family members, neighborhood people, all of them have played a big part in my life and who I am today. And I feel like it's an unspoken tradition that we give back." Another intriguing quote from the article was, "It's a magical thing that happens here in New Orleans that we can't figure out yet, but we're just going with it. I think it's the influences of different people here. From Fats Domino to Louis Armstrong to the Neville Brothers to Master P, being in this close city, at some point we all cross paths and work with each other. So we get influenced by different styles of music and all it to be in our music. We just put it all in one pot. I think if I wasn't from here, we probably wouldn't be playing as much as we are now." Now it's time to move on to some musical analysis of some Trombone Shorty songs. The songs analyzed in this documentary are Hurricane Season off of the Buckatown album and My Very Good Friend the Milkman off of Eric Clapton's Clapton album. The song Hurricane Season gives examples of the jazz history and influences which came to shape Troy Trombone Shorty Andrews' music. First, the shout sections of this song represent the big band era styles, which were popularized by artists like Count Basie in the 1930s jazz scene. Heavily syncopated percussion throughout the piece is also representative of the complex mixture of African and Western styles, which persists since its emergence into popular music from New Orleans. Therefore, the song Hurricane Season shows influence from both big band styles, which evolved and flourished in the city jazz scene up north, and the meshing of African and Western elements into America's own original music culture in Andrew's hometown of New Orleans. Moving on to the breakdown of the song, the piece begins with a short 8-bar long introduction of Andrews on the trombone with accompaniment by a lively syncopated drum and bongo beat. At the end of the introduction, a guitar riff transitions along with the drums into the first of the melodies, in which Andrew's trumpet and alto saxophone create a homophonic texture, while tenor sax, trombone, guitar, and bass guitar play their own riffs to form a shout texture. Upon the end of the second chorus, just 8 bars of the first melody are played again. After this interlude, 12 bars of the background riff accompanies an alto saxophone solo. This saxophone carries as screaming timbre. When soloing ends, all the instruments come to a head to play the second melody together and a shout chorus texture. This shout chorus plays the second melody for 8 bars, and on the final first beat ends the song with a bass lick.
We'll be right back.
My very good friend the Milkman, though not a piece arranged and led by Andrews, instead shows his adaptability and skill within a realm of jazz music that is not typically his own music, but definitely had influence on his style of playing. First, the two-beat rhythm is a musical feature which is suggestive of influence from the works of big band composers like Benny Mountain and his song South. This leads to a certain link between big band music that Andrews would have been exposed to in early times as a jazz musician in New Orleans. What is more important about Andrews' part in this piece, however, is the way in which he paid tribute to the New Orleans jazz style by incorporating his own take on a collective improvisation as one musician. With the help of a clarinet improviser, Andrews had recorded both the trombone and trumpet tracks, which played over most of this song as leading elements of a polyphonic structure. This type of collective improvisation and accompaniment of strings, drums, and bass in the background mirror the innovative values of musicians from New Orleans in the early days of popular jazz, such as Louis Armstrong and his Potato Head Blues. Therefore, although this was not an arrangement by Andrews himself, it showed that he still had an appreciative and precise sense of the New Orleans musical style, which characterized the same city in which he grew up and learned to be an innovator himself. Now looking at the breakdown of the song. The introduction begins with a small rundown lick, which is typical of blues music. The song melody begins after the introduction with a 2-beat percussion texture between the 2-4 beats of the hi-hat cymbal and 1-3 beats of the walking tuba bass line. Between the trumpet and trombone improvisations played by Andrews and those of a clarinet player comes a polyphonic collective improvisation, which is supported by an accompaniment of slightly varying comping piano riffs, a walking bass on both the trombone and string bass, syncopated drumming beats, and Clapton singing. The first piano solo by Walter Richman is improvised over the first A of the second chorus. After Richman, another pianist, Alan Toussaint, begins his solo on the second chorus, second A. Over this piano soloing, the bass, trombone, and trumpet improvised melodies become softer and fade away into the background so as to accompany and support the piano improvisations. The second and final bridge of only 8 bars is in which full trombone, trumpet, clarinet, and slightly more harmonic piano playing comes to a head and background accompaniment returns in full as well. The final A of the second chorus, over which collective improvisation of other instruments is again accompanied by piano, bass, and tuba, as well as drums.
My very good friend, the Milkman, says that I've been losing too much sleep. He doesn't like the hours I keep, and he suggests that you should marry me.
Now to look at Trombone Shorty's discography. This is separated into two different segments, one being the beginnings, where he is finding his sound, and more recent years, where he's staying true to his jazz roots. Troy Andrews' official recording career began in 2002 with the release of Trombone Shorty's Swinging Gate, which encompassed a characteristically cool jazz sound with music qualities heavily reminiscent of his hometown, New Orleans. Andrews' recording prowess expanded with a live recording release of the Live at New Orleans Jazz Fest album in 2004, and even more so with the release of his two 2005 albums, The End of the Beginnings and Orleans and Claiborne. He released subsequent live jazz festival performance albums from 2006 to 2008. In the midst of working on his own anthology in these earlier years, Andrews was also a regular sit-in for both live performances and studio recording sessions of various popular musical groups. This is highlighted in Andrews' brass contribution in a live collaboration performance by U2 and Green Day of songs Wake Me Up When September Ends, House of the Rising Sun, and The Saints Are Coming, at a show celebrating the reopening of the New Orleans Superdome in 2006 after Hurricane Katrina. Andrews later released his first critically acclaimed album, Buckatown, under the Verve Forecast record label in 2010. This album featured a milestone opening instrumental piece titled Hurricane Season, which encompasses powerful jazz brass sounds along with elements of blues and rock. That year also included another rock collaboration, this time on Eric Clapton's self-titled album, Clapton. In the song My Very Good Friend the Milkman, Andrews plays both trombone and trumpet over a track suggested of the big band jazz ensembles with bombastic brass timbres like the trumpet, growl, collective improvisation, and two-beat. This work under the direction of Clapton served as yet another tribute to his roots in New Orleans jazz, as well as underscores the movement of Andrews into a more experimental jazz-rock fusion he had started at this time. He has since then released three more albums, For True, Say That to Say This, and Parking Lot Symphony. Andrews' latest work in Parking Lot Symphony shows another shift to lighter musical textures in the form of more intricately composed pieces. Last up, we have the bibliography, which lists all the sources used to create this documentary. Thank you for watching this in-depth look into the life of Trombone Shorty.